Warning, Supernatural the Crossroads contains adult language and discussions. If you're easily offended, do not continue to listen.
Episode of Supernatural the Crossroads on Rain Man Digital, Crossroads 003. I am your host, Thomas Cowley. Joined with me is Ryan Denton.
What up?
And Michael Flores, as always.
I'm gonna kick your ass first. And then yours.
Who do you think's first in that? You or me? I would say you, honestly.
What the fuck was that drop? I seriously didn't hear a word of it, dude. It was like,
he said, I'm gonna kick your ass first, and then I'm gonna kick yours. I think you're first. You always give him crap.
I'm the one that always gives Mike shit.
I just want to be loved.
Oh, wow. I got that's a good drop.
As always, guys, you can now listen to the show on the Rain Man Digital app, which you can get in the Google Play Store. Mike, is the iTunes up yet, or is that still in work in progress at this point?
It needs Viagra. It's not up yet.
It needs Viagra.
Yeah,
it's not it up. Needs a little stimulation.
Mike has plenty of that, too.
2 minutes. That's the fastest.
Going for a new record? Should we just try and keep doing that?
Cock. There we go. How's that?
Yeah, it's got to be well
played. You can't just throw it out.
I'll well play it.
You can't just force it in, like.
Yeah, you can't rape it, dude. You can't rape
the punchline.
Yeah, you can't rape the punchline, okay?
Yeah.
Sometimes you got it. Never mind.
All right.
I'm ready.
We also had a couple comments we wanted to address, and apparently, I guess we'll call this... the defend ourselves.
Well, I want to. I actually
clear the air.
Read this first one, and then I want to read it how it was typed. Is that possible? Can I do that?
Yeah, I mean, she's a good listener.
No. I know. So. I'm just saying.
This is I think she's a new listener.
This is how it. This is how I. When I read it the first time, this is how I read it. So I want to read the comment first, and I'll say.
Okay. All right.
All right. It says interesting podcast. Enjoyed it, except obviously there's a script for the season finale.
Okay, so you read it, and then this is how it sounds. Interesting podcast. Enjoyed it, except obviously there's a script for the season finale.
You just pulled what everyone does to text messages when you're not trying to be an asshole, and that's why LOL is in every fucking really sentence now.
She's been, I think she's on Twitter, and she's a friend of Dancing Adrift and that group.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, cool. Yeah, I think, so she's pretty cool, but... You know, and that's also Nadia Espien also said something similar. She said it would be great if you guys did an interview with, you know, the people involved in the production of Supernatural, yada, yada, yada. And then she said,
that'd be nice.
You guys suck.
Oh, I didn't write that part. And then she also said she alluded to the fact that we were wrong again, saying there is a script for the season finale. It's actually being shot right now. And she posted a link.
Right.
But
they have to understand that we heard that information from Jared and Jensen.
And, yeah. And that was also
a month ago.
That was also over a month ago.
Yeah.
And we
I'd hope they'd have something by now.
Right. A month ago, I'm going to stand by that. Even though people are saying we were wrong, I stand by it because Jared Padalecki said that.
Look, guys.
Unless there's no reason for him to say that.
Yeah.
Look, secondly,
now hold on. And then you could jump in there, but I just want to make sure people understand that last week when we did the show, we weren't saying that they still don't have a script. We were discussing a topic that was brought up over a month ago. So just so you guys know, we're not idiots. We're aware they probably have a script, especially since, you know, one of the producers actually tweeted it out saying, hey guys, we're shooting the finale. I'm like, well, chances are you have a script. If you're not The Walking Dead, you probably have a script at this point.
Oh boy. Another Walking Dead shot.
Such hate.
Anyways, look, guys, here at Supernatural the Crossroads, we are always fucking right. So please stop telling us we're wrong. And
It's disrespectful. Frankly.
Honestly, frankly, this show is perfect. And the fact that you guys question us is horseshit. So I'm just kidding.
Hitler now produces the show.
And now you can all stop listening because we're stupid.
No, I would get that if people have only caught recent ones,
right, and I
didn't hear the conference essentially that we had,
right?
You know, so right. But I do stand by the fact that that's what they told us then. That was right. A month ago, and they very well could have gotten that done the next day for all we know.
Exactly.
So
you sounded like a doctor.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So in other news, guys, about the show, we've got a little bit of details for our 50th episode celebration party thing. We're actually going to have a full-on party now.
Dude, full-on. So it's a party now. Do I need to bring party favors?
You need to bring Coke.
Actually, I think I'm going to bring the little dick toppers that go on like straws.
It's so, like a bachelorette party.
Like a bachelorette party so chicks can suck on little dick tips for their drinks. Is that?
It might be too much.
Is that too much?
Might be. Yeah. Oh, I guess it would depend on where we're going.
I already bought them for your...
This is a den of iniquity.
I already bought them for your birthday party.
Oh,
there's a puppy.
So what are the details we have to share with us? A couple of questions about that?
Yeah, well, we mentioned a few shows ago that we were, because we didn't really want to take part in creation entertainment type stuff for a while.
For a bit, yeah.
So we figured that we would do our own live show. Remember I suggested we do a live show?
Yeah, I remember you saying that. So are we going to bring like cupcakes or what is this deal going
to
be?
Is that what comes to your mind when you hear party?
Dude, well, there's three things that come to party. I think of strippers.
Jello shots.
I think of cupcakes. And I think of jello shots. Jello shots. Yeah, that's a good one. Wow. Doing body shots off Thomas?
Jesus.
What?
So what I think we're going to do is, I said we're going to have some type of live show event. And we would invite people to view the show, hang out, have drinks. I don't know if we're going to have a party with streamers and like those little blow things.
Yeah. We're not, no poppers.
But I figured that we would have, you know, some type of an event that we put together. A small event. A live show, pretty much. And we are going to do that for the 50th show. We're on, this is, I think, show 40. We're not going to go by our actual number, which is we don't count the preview show. So right here will be show 40. So we have 10 shows. And the way Thomas and I were discussing this off air, and the way it came up, it looks like it'll be during Hellatus.
Yeah.
Which is fine, because we're going to be doing shows every other week, like last summer, right?
Right.
So. So every other so we have, how many more episodes do we have this season? We have about roughly,
do we know how many
another
this
five
season
or six
has in total? Is yeah, it 22 do we know or 24? Total?
I'm not quite sure. Either way, it looks like
let me Google that.
Go ahead. Either
about
way,
5 to 7.
Yeah, so that's going to push us up to say 44 to 46 episodes that we burn through. So, then we have every other week we'll have a Hellatus episode during the summertime.
Have we figured out not to offshoot here, but have we figured out what Hellatus is going to be? Like
we're gonna continue our Hellatus specials.
Oh.
And we'll add some things in there. And I'm also gonna, a lot of our interviews will be coming in hopefully in the summertime.
Oh, okay.
That'd be nice.
Just to kind of give us some more content. So we figured probably July, it looks like, right? If we go by, if we're estimating,
probably,
it looks kind of like
by guesstimation,
July. It looks about July.
Let's hope it's not the second week of July.
Yeah, we got to plan everything around Ryan's single guy schedule now.
That's San Diego Comic-Con, bro. That's a big deal.
Okay, yeah.
Sorry.
Since you're single.
Single guy Ryan, yeah. San Diego Comic-Con is, I plan on staying in a different hotel room every night.
You didn't buy a hotel, you're just going to... Stay at other people's, right?
Yeah, I mean, that's the plan, dude.
Yeah. make sure you change out condoms every night, too.
No, you leave the same one on. Isn't that how it works?
So you're prepared?
Is that
prepared?
Not how it works? I have one. That's perfect.
The
that's
visual.
Funny, right? It's crusty after the first one, but you just throw a little lube on it.
All the jism just piled up in there.
I don't jizz, bro.
I think you need to get that checked out.
Dude. Jesus Christ, you need a doctor.
This is a den of iniquity. I should not be here.
Good Lord.
Jealous. Oh, my God.
So, Hellatus is what we're looking at right now. That's what people can look
there's
forward
a puppy.
To.
Yeah, we're looking at July.
Okay, cool. So, guys, as always, when we know a little bit more about that, we will let you know.
We'll get the dates. Right, we'll get the venue out. if you have any ideas or venues out, listeners out there who live in the Valley, the Phoenix Valley,
then let us know.
I mean, I have some on my mind, but if you have some better options, you know,
Buffalo Wild Wings. I mean, you know,
come on,
we
can't do a show there.
Hooters?
Like Supernatural Losers.
Yeah, bro, can you shut up? I'm watching the football game, dumbass.
Yeah. So.
In July?
Yeah, it's CFL.
Arena football. I think you're the loser. Oh, if you're watching arena football, you're the loser.
Bro, did you see that pass against the wall?
All right, so the big news that we've got is that Jared Padalecki has said in an interview that the season finale for season 10 is, quote, traumatic.
Yeah, he goes on
to read this. Even though it's not written yet.
Right, yeah.
Ryan,
can you read this for us?
Yeah, absolutely. He goes, meanwhile, a casting report from instars.com.
Yeah.
That's a website. Indicated that the show's final season is being touted as far more upsetting when compared to Dean's transformation in season 9. Speaking to Seattle Salute to Supernatural on Sunday, Padalecki reveals some details about the season ending. We are filming in the final arc of season 10 right now, and it's one of those really intense final arcs. I mean, it's probably the most intense I can remember since like season 5 or something like that. The actor said, the final episodes are very traumatic. So
I think that, okay, I mean, you guys tell me what you think, but I think that lends credence to the idea that Kane kind of predicted some stuff for the show as a whole. And I think that has to mean major character death.
Yeah, but who?
Well, because season 5 you had, you know, Ellen and Joe death. Season 7 you have Bobby. Even if you want to go by season 5, you had Cass, Bobby, and almost Sam, you know, or technically Sam at that point.
They lied. There's not no a season lot. 11. They're just going to kill everyone off.
Kill everyone. There's not a lot of people
season
left.
11 will take place in heaven.
So,
dude, you'd shit if that was actually the...
That'd be so terrible.
That'd be so bad.
It's all in white walls.
It's all white walls.
It's all
walls.
White hallways.
They're all wearing white.
Yeah.
Oh, God. Shoot me now.
No, but I do think that has to be major character death, like Kane said, you know, maybe start with Crowley or the angel.
No.
What else? What can you think of that would be traumatic?
Your own personal feelings? Yeah, are you basing your no answer on personal feelings only?
Well, no. You're not killing Cass. You're not killing Crowley. You're not killing Sam and Dean. You're not killing the big four.
But what says that?
Dude, seriously?
They've killed Sam and Dean before.
I'm not going to, I don't want to call it because I don't want the listeners to be, I don't want the writers to listen to this right now, but hopefully the finale is already written so they won't take this. I'm going to say something and I don't want to believe it myself.
Okay.
But after this past episode.
You think Crowley's going to die?
I think Crowley's going to die, dude.
I think he's first.
Do you?
I
think there's a lot of reasons.
I don't know
that.
Necessarily if Dean will do it. And if he does, it'll be in a very like unwilling way.
When you said after this past episode and I started thinking about the episode,
I mean, that conversation, I don't want to get into it yet, but that conversation between Dean and Crowley meant something, man.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, I think we were all kind of cuddling after that on the couch.
We were cuddling.
More than we already were.
We were already cuddling.
So when he says traumatic, I mean, everyone knows, the writers know how much we love Crowley. There isn't anybody out there at this point.
I just don't see them actually.
I'm not saying, I'm not calling it. I'm not doing one of those.
Yeah. You're just saying that's what you think.
I'm just saying.
You're saying that's going to happen.
I think it might. I'm leaving the possibility that it might. I'm not calling. I don't feel 100% sure on it. But what's traumatic?
I see Metatron dying.
That's not traumatic.
Celebratory.
People want that to happen.
Oh, is that a good thing? Oh. Yeah, I want that
people
to happen.
People want that to happen.
I see.
I'm your dickwad.
No, you're not. That's the problem.
I see Crowley going before Cass. I think Kane's story, you have to mirror that a bit.
They've set Rowena up in a certain...
She's been set up for some vengeful crap.
Right.
And, we'll get back to that.
And think about it, okay?
You can
now,
be vengeful to me.
Think about this, okay? Rowena, they set her up as the main villain towards the end of the season. She wasn't the villain the entire season, but they set it up to where she's going to be what they're up against. Obviously, the Mark Kane issue is there, but that's more abstract. Rowena's more of the tangible villain, okay?
Yeah,
and I don't think Metatron's done yet either, but Rowena is very unique. She's an emotional villain. We haven't quite seen a villain like her, I don't think, in 10 seasons. Meaning, we had Lucifer... he was a great actor. He was an awesome villain, but it wasn't emotional. It wasn't. They set her up to have this, even though she's very manipulative, I don't feel like she really cares about Crowley.
No.
But she is angry.
She's very
angry. She's hot, redheaded, I'm going to kill you anger.
The other villains have always looked at the Winchesters as an annoyance or a means to an end. Like Azazel, they were annoying, slash Sam was the chosen one for them.
Right.
Lilith, she needed to be killed, so they were end goal. Lucifer knew he would win. The Leviathans never really gave a shit.
Right. This, she has emotional anger towards
them. She has a reason to gun them down.
Right. Yeah. And because they did that, I could see how she's got to tie in directly into this traumatic event that Padalecki's talking about. Padalecki is talking about.
I say just bring Kevin back and kill him again. Just get rid of him again.
I mean, Kevin's like, hey guys, I bet. Stab.
That would be awesome, dude.
Very traumatic.
Oh, so traumatic. Oh, he's back. Oh, my God.
Oh,
he's dead again.
All right, then.
So, you know, we can talk about this more later.
We'll
like
get into
theory,
it in the next segment.
Absolutely, you know?
But either way, that's setting up for, I think, that home run that Carver's needed.
Ooh, whoa.
Yes.
Yes.
That we've been talking about.
People, we thought 8 was great, the season finale of 8 with the angels falling.
It was a great.
A lot of people really lost their crap with 9. But if Padalecki himself is saying this one's messed up, it harkens back to seasons 1 through 5.
You like that word, harkens, by the way.
I do. It's a good word.
It is a good word.
Then that really has to be a big impact for something.
For 10 years,
for him to be like, yeah, this is pretty big.
For Jared to say it and be super, you know, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. So with that, guys, we're going to take a quick break, and then we'll get into our breakdown of episode 17, Inside Man.
Harkens.
Express straight to heaven. No time for goodbyes.
I'm here about Castiel. Was there any of his grace left?
Question is, are you willing to pay for it?
He must be returned intact. Is that clear?
Told you last time I saw you, I'd get out of the slammer.
Need to know how to remove the mark of Cain from Dean's arm.
He's gone nuclear. Who knew the mark was so toxic? Actually, I did.
What is the next step in removing this mark from my arm?
The river shall end at the source!
You ever ask me for help again, I will choose death.
You're gonna get worse!
Mommy.
Fergus, you think I've been manipulating you? I am your mother, after all.
We can be a family.
I've been thinking just how wretched it would be if my own raison d'etre were taken from me.
Does this mean that you'll go to the Grand Coven on my behalf?
Even better, I've brought the Coven to you. I believe you know Oliver.
These friends of yours? The Winchesters? I hear they are, what you call them? Men of letters?
My relationship with the Winchesters is my business. I'll handle them. Not killing them.
All right, dearie. Of course. Whatever you see.
iHome. Everybody should be going to iHome. iHomeAudio.com. In just its first year, iHome became the number one brand in the iPod electronics market. And its iPod clock radio became and continues to be the number one selling iPod speaker system in North America. iHome now offers full lines of alarm clocks, clock radios, portable speakers, home audio systems, headphones, and a licensed line of iPhone, iPad, and Mac accessories. So if you want to listen to our show in a casual manner, take it on the go, at the beach summer.
I have one, man. It's awesome. The sound quality is amazing.
Yeah, I need new one because I have just a regular alarm clock right now, and it's like it's getting old. Pieces are shaking inside
it. And you could set it to Crossroads 003 on TuneIn.
Exactly.
To wake up to your own voice. That's
weird, right?
Yeah. Awful. Whatever girl sitting laying next to you at night is going to wake up to that show. You are either crazy or cool.
You are fucking cool.
Thomas, is that your voice on the alarm clock right now?
Wow. Yeah, you're goddamn right it is.
So go to iHomeAudio.com and click in, type in Rain Man at checkout. That's RAINMAN, all one word, at checkout. Thank you. Previously on Supernatural The Crossroads.
Portrait.
Well,
it
looked like the Mona Lisa.
And when he said he wasn't in love with her, I thought it was Da Vinci.
You're like, dang. Dude, okay, hold on.
Single guy, right?
Hold on, let's bro out for a second. The blonde chick that he was banging totally looked like it didn't look like a chick that would be from that time, okay?
She looked like she was from California.
Chicks from the 1520s don't look like chicks from California.
Did you live in the 1520s, dude?
Hell yeah, bro. I've seen portraits. Dude, they were haggard. They were fucking haggard. Dude, they had like measles and the fucking Black Death back then, dude.
I was more considering the fact that she's blonde and it's in Italy.
Yeah, that doesn't happen.
The rest of them look
she's
haggard.
Like, oh my god, dude, are you gonna fuck
guys,
me or
they,
not?
They have fair skinned like people out there, like fair skinned, blue eyed.
No, but it's
blonde.
Not as common.
Like, oh my god, I don't do anything cool. Just people want to fuck me.
So dumb. I'm a guy.
Cali girl, Ryan.
I'll stick your paintbrush in me.
Just fuck me with your paintbrush, you stupid bitch.
Now he's gay.
Now you're violent about it.
Now he's Perez Hill for some reason.
Was that even on? Welcome, everybody, to Supernatural The Crossroads again. Segment 2. Now we're going to be talking about the most recent episode that we saw just minutes ago, Inside Man.
Inside Men.
Ryan, you got the synopsis for this?
Yeah. Episode was written by Andrew Dobb and directed by Rashad Ernesto Green. See, that's how you say names, Thomas.
See, thank you.
It's actually Dab, I think.
No, you fucked up.
Yeah. You got uppity with it. Call it Dobb.
I did. Well, the name's Dumas. The synopsis is Dean and Rowena face off against each other. Sam and Castiel follow up on a lead about the Mark of Cain, which we find out is... Never mind. Let's not jump ahead.
Yeah. Okay. So we actually have some audio about Carver discussing this episode.
Play the audio.
And we want to thank Maddie for sending this.
This is Carver.
Thanks for coming, Cass.
Of course. Where's Dean?
This is about Dean. He's getting worse.
Episode 17 is called Inside Man, and this is the episode where the boys are starting to withhold some things from each other.
What the hell are you doing here?
Saving my son.
Your son?
Dean has an encounter with Rowena, which will forever change his relationship with Crowley.
Yes, we've gone through every other option possible. We gotta talk about
it. Don't say it.
Do you think I want this? I'm not a fan of it either. But if we want to get rid of the mark...
Sam enlists Castiel to find a means to help save Dean from the Mark of Cain, which involves communicating with a very old friend up in heaven, none other than Bobby Singer.
Sam?
The only thing that was interesting in that audio was that we didn't really know was it's going to change his relationship with Crowley forever.
Yeah, it absolutely. Yeah.
Very interesting choice of words.
I think Carver was more foreshadowing future episodes than what actually happened in this episode.
This is the moment that changes everything, but it's not showing us how much has changed.
Some might say it's the catalyst.
Oh, look at Ryan with the words.
Ryan has a dictionary with him.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. Is that what that is?
Yes. Well, it's a dick.
Tab.
It's a dictionary.
This is a den of iniquity. I should not be here. You're a sick puppy.
Yeah.
True. I mean,
yeah, we're not denying that at all.
No, not at all.
He made a comment about how this is the episode in which the brothers start hiding things from each other, and that was
one of the, like, when we were taking notes,
definitely picked up on
one
that.
Of the one things I wrote down was they're lying to each other again, like
bringing it back,
just straight up
season lying. 1 through 5.
Yeah,
well, they did it last year a lot, but it was different.
Last year was different.
This is old school lying. This is season 4, season 5 type lines.
Yeah,
yeah.
I mean, we start the episode with a little mini flash forward, and I think that was just to give us the Bobby scene.
That was a Tarantino, bro.
Frankly,
you know, they started off, and then
yeah,
and it just started off. I like how it started off with them holding hands. They're around the table, and I'm like, okay, this is cool. And as soon, I just like that he had that sidekick, and that's how they connected to Bobby. And it was a good way, even though we're going to see a more detailed version of it down later in the episode. The way they introduced Bobby back in. Yeah, it did bring up some issues that we had that we'll talk about later. Just, you know. Yeah. It was more cynical of us to, you know, but.
Yeah.
But. Did you say sidekick or psychic?
Supposed to be psychic. What are you, the Twitter listeners? Come on.
I know, right?
Mike, that's not correct. You said sidekick. Hashtag dumbass.
Hey, dude, someone's got to keep us in line. Let the listeners keep us in line.
What a terrible job.
Yeah.
Sorry, guys. You have to do that.
Yeah. So I like that. And I did like the connection where, you know, they talk through the radio. And the Kenny Rogers introduction was so Bobby.
That was so Bobby.
Yeah, it was good. I definitely enjoyed that little teaser.
You know, we see that. I mean, Dean had been playing it kind of, you know, everything's fine. I feel great. Nothing's a problem. But now we see Sam witnessing Dean's night terrors. That's the only way to describe it.
I mean, that was pretty.
It was morbid. A little morbid.
It was very morbid, dude. And then for him to get up the next morning and be like, "Oh no, I was fine. You know, I was great." And it's like, dude,
he's faking it full on, dude.
Oh, hardcore. Full on,
he's lying to himself, I think, at this point too.
He's full on chicken it, dude. Yeah. He is just faking that orgasm, dude.
Had a lot of experience with that.
No, I haven't.
It gave him night terrors.
Yeah. Shut up. I'm speaking from experience. I thought this was a safe place.
But I think the best thing about that night terror sequence was the Kane voiceover. Reminding us, you know, because that had been just a few episodes ago, but still saying, you know, of this is how this story ends.
Yeah. Well, it shows you that that's what he's actually having dreams about.
He's afraid of it. He's afraid.
Not, and that's so Dean, and that's why I loved it. He's not having dreams of becoming a demon again
and killing him.
He's having nightmares about him killing his brother, Castiel, and Crowley. That is what he's dreaming about.
Yep.
That's fears all the way back to season 2.
Yeah.
That, you know, dad saying you might have to kill your brother.
Yeah. I mean, I the way this season's closing out, man, again, we have a few episodes to go, but I'm actually, I might be enjoying this season a bit more than last year. I did like last year.
I actually agree with you on that, dude.
I did like last year, but I think just there's some elements that they're putting in here. They're sprinkling here and there. Ooh, that
sprinkling.
The first half of the season was kind of slow, but the second half is kind of picking up. And if they keep going like the way they're going, I think I'm going to end up liking this episode better. Or this season better.
I think we'll see how the season ends, but I'm actually in agreement with you, man. I just, something about this season with the Kane and the mark of Kane, and just something about it, man.
I think it's the fact that it's much more personal, you know, and it gives us a lot of stuff that reminded us of why we love the show in the first place. The early seasons, the brothers are not at odds. And that had been something that they've been dealing with for a long, long time, you know.
And that's the difference with the lies. The lies were last season, the season before that, were more lies because they were butting heads.
And I think that's what it is. This is nostalgia in a way.
Yeah, these lies are more personal, they're at peace with each other, but they're also lying to each other to protect each other.
Yeah, exactly.
Which never ends good either.
No, and they should have known that by now.
Yeah.
But I mean, season 7, you had... Their whole world was changed. They're not even in the baby anymore. Different car, different life, you know, different season, different show, it felt at some points. Season 8 and 9, they're kind of at the worst point probably they have been in since the Ruby falling out of season 4.
Yeah.
You know, but now we have all the way back to the early seasons. They're being brothers. They're pranking each other. They're making jokes.
It's one of the funniest stuff in this episode.
Yeah,
too.
We saw that in the episode. Like, you know, stay out of my room. What are you guys, 14?
Exactly.
Like, stay out of my room. And then the next scene, is Dean in, the room. In his room taking his freaking toothbrush and scraping his underarm with it.
Dude, like, that's the kind of stuff my older brother did to me too. Did to me when I was a kid.
Probably.
I was.
Good God.
I was very OCD. Like, very obsessive and compulsive. And I would, like, dude, don't touch my Legos. Leave my Legos exactly where they are. I was
don't
a
touch
kid
my drum set.
That had my Legos perfectly set up. And I knew, because I wouldn't dust my room on purpose because I would know the imprints of the dust would be different.
Mission Impossible over
so
here.
So I never dusted certain areas very much because I wanted to make sure my Legos stayed the same because that was bizarre. And I would come home and they would be all, my brother would just move them just a tiny bit. All of them. He would take swords and put swords in other people's hands, and I would know. And I'm like, dude, that's just too much effort. So when I saw Dean doing that, I'm like, that's just too much effort.
Well, here's what I thought was funny is that he tapes the receiver on the phone, and I'm like,
who's gonna call?
I'm like, who the fuck is gonna call that old ass dial fucking phone, dude?
Oh my god, dude.
I just thought that was funny, dude. To watch them.
Well, even
and that's the whole
even
thing.
Sam's way out of making sure Dean doesn't come with him.
It's a French movie.
Was so good. He's like, he knew exactly what Dean turn... was, and so believable that Sam, you know, the more intellectual,
exactly,
you know, would actually go see something like that. It was funny.
He's like the New York Times, and Dean's like, who cares?
Who gives a shit?
And I think that's exactly why this season has kind of done that for us. It's nostalgia. The brothers are themselves.
It's very much like the older seasons.
And we're
getting the brothers.
They're not fighting anymore.
Yeah, the whole fighting thing, and I think we even discussed this when it was happening, was it was like 7 episodes of them just being angry at each other.
Yeah.
And it let it sink in. And I think now that we're getting them almost completely back to normal, I mean, I'm using air quotations here. It's refreshing and it's fun.
Yeah.
It's fun to see them again. Yeah, fun again. Yeah.
You know. So fake movie aside, we see that he's meeting up with Cass, who it still makes me laugh that Cass has to drive a car.
Yeah. Dude, you know? And his
where's
car's
he getting
such
money
a hoopty,
for gas?
Bro, dude. Like, dude, he's
giving
blowjobs.
Where did any of them get money?
I don't know.
Like,
well,
have they
Sam
found,
and Dean, they've explained
have
that.
Have they found a fucking spell in the middle letters bunker that can just conjure up money?
Hey, Dean hustled some dudes.
Yeah.
They've always had, you know, credit card fraud and hustling and stuff like that as money for Sam
and
Dean.
How are they hustling anybody? They're in a bunker. I want to see it.
The bunker has its own vault of savings or something like that for international trips and all the stuff that the men of letters would have to do.
Yeah.
But at the same time, my biggest question is Cass.
He's not going to stop until we acknowledge him.
Yeah.
He's been
I need shit to throw.
Ryan's been fake blowing the air for probably a minute.
Yeah.
And we didn't acknowledge it because we're trying to move on. So he literally does not stop.
God damn it.
I said this while we were watching the TV show.
I know.
Ryan is the little brother that nobody ever wanted.
Hey. Thomas, you gonna watch the trailer? Yeah. Are you gonna watch the trailer? There's a trailer coming up. Are you gonna watch the trailer?
Dude, he's trolling the entire episode. He's trolling.
You're
the, whole
be time, the whole time.
I'm fuck Rowena. The whole time. Like, holy shit, dude.
That's not what I said.
No, I believe you said that she could ride you, something like that. It was a little
Shut
different.
Up.
You should have saw his face when the blood sigils happened.
Oh, dude, the blood sigil.
We'll get to that.
Well,
God
hold on. That was one of my notes. It says, hold on. Let me read it. I'm going to read it.
Sigil
Rowena
boner.
Naked and the symbols.
It's his only note.
Exactly.
Let's clarify note, not notes.
Exactly.
Shut up. I have hot points.
All right. Let's move into this.
No. So we see that Sam's hiding stuff from Dean, that they need to, their plan again is let's go to Metatron and talk to him because that worked out so well the first time.
That's when I was watching the episode. I'm like, why are we doing this again? Like, I know we're bringing Metatron back in to bring Metatron.
It's desperation.
No, yes.
And that the angels say that when they get there. It's obvious from the point of view of Sam and Cass at this point.
You said desperation, and you hit it on the head, but it's a bit more than that. They're coming at this in a different way. It is desperation, but also they have shit got real in their eyes. Like, this is, we're not going to fuck around. I think they were both willing to fucking kill Metatron. And that's the difference between now.
They were tired of
gnarly,
games.
Right.
Dude.
They were, I think they were willing to put the bullet into Metatron's head than deal with how they were the beginning of the season.
Absolutely.
And it all goes back to desperation, like you said. I mean, the fact that they turned Metatron human.
Oh, the
immortal.
I didn't foresee
that happening.
Why didn't any of us think of that?
I didn't see that happening. I didn't see.
It kind of makes you get pissed off that they just didn't do it earlier.
I know. Yeah, I'm like, fuck, God damn it. Man. This whole time.
Pass. Just sack you know up, what?
And that's the thing about when you're on season 10 of a show, there's a lot of questions. You're like, why didn't you do that before? Why didn't you do this before?
Yeah.
And so you got to let some things go because you're 10 years in.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, the whole Metatron thing was pretty intense. It kind of solidified kind of what we thought. Metatron doesn't know shit. He's just trying to survive.
He's a fucking weasel, dude. That's why
he's a snake in the grass.
He's a weasel.
Yeah. I mean, they gave Gadriel crap for letting the snake into paradise, you know. Metatron's that fucking snake, dude.
Yeah.
Dude, he is a snake.
Well, do you think heaven is making a comeback now? I don't want to jump too far ahead, but the fact that they were willing to shut the door on Castiel.
Well, yeah, I mean that after we find out that they aren't let into heaven, they have guards stationed just so Cass won't show up.
They were ready for him. They said, we have orders not to let you in.
Yeah.
And then that's when Hannah shows up.
Yeah.
Hannah's
just not as hot as she was.
No, something's different about her.
That was so gay.
But kudos on that actor, though.
The guy did really well.
Holy fuck, dude.
I bought that was
the transformation of his face went from dude to chick.
Yeah.
That's good acting. That's some talent right there. And those are just that's a little thing that sells him as an actor. The fact that he went from
he did a very good job.
It wasn't even the words yet or the voice. It was the facial expression.
Yeah.
It was the eyes, dude. Yeah, man. It was good. He did a good job on that. But it was a little disturbing just because Hannah was hot and you're just like, oh,
it was. It did throw me a little bit.
Why couldn't you get at least, possess a hot chick at least?
Yeah, like, come on.
Why is it
she's got possession standards?
Yeah.
Dude, if you're not possessing over an 8, Hannah, come on.
Do you think Castiel would still want a boner?
I don't know. How does that work with angels? He's been human. I don't think it would work.
Do you think Castiel would still want to bone Hannah even though it's a guy?
So is that gay?
It's not gay. It goes back to Crowley and Rowena. It's not really, him. It's a
but I'm saying, like, is that,
it's a meat suit.
But is it gay?
No.
Because he's not going to be able to do the guy in the vagina. He's going to do him in the butt.
A mangina, though. You can do that. A mangina.
Good Lord.
It's a woman. It's Hannah.
Yeah. But it's a dick.
I don't know. Let's get Bruce Jenner on the line. See what he says.
Oh
my God.
Right.
Kind of like a possession.
Yeah.
That's sort of a possession, only it's willful.
Anyway.
Well, you have to be willful for an angel to possess you.
Hi. Would you like to possess me?
This is a den of iniquity.
That's just like the theme of today.
Yeah, that's, dude. This is what happens when we record a show.
So
right
we
after
find,
show.
I know, right? So we find out that they can't get in through the front door in many ways. And they go with plan B, which I like how plan B is immediately, let's break Metatron out of heaven.
Yeah.
You know, there's not even like a in between. They're just like, all right, well, if they won't let us in, we'll just go full on, Ocean's 11.
Yeah, it was black or white, dude. There's no gray there. It's we're either getting in or we're not.
Well, they're desperate, man.
Yeah.
You know, Hannah was right.
Time,
and it kind of makes you wonder, like, is Hannah actually did something, I think, even though it was kind of, added confrontation to the Winchesters, and I think, as we can see, it's going to end up coming back in the end.
To bite them, yeah.
But,
has reason and justification.
She's one of the few angels that's actually protecting heaven for the good. She knows that if Metatron, they're not thinking straight, and she knows that Metatron left out is not good for anybody.
Well, she knows that he's
and
lying.
She's afraid that they're going to kill him, which they're trying not to do that. They're trying to show a new heaven, a new version of heaven,
right?
You know, under her kind of, even though there's no ruler, she's kind of
in charge right now.
Yeah,
I mean, Castiel was all of their leader after, was it Bartholomew? And the other leaders were taken out. And if Hannah was his number two, makes sense that she'd kind of assume that role.
She's obviously in charge. She's possessing other angels. Like, she's
one angel got kicked out.
Hey, fuck face, get out of this body. I'm going to possess his body real quick. Like, she's obviously in charge, dude.
I mean, there's a good reason to bring Bobby back, though.
You know what?
Yeah.
I always say, if you're going to bring a character back, it's better work.
For a reason.
And the way they did it, it worked. And it was for a reason.
It worked. It was for a reason. It didn't feel contrived. It didn't feel like they were doing it just because, hey, it's the 10th season. Let's bring him back. It felt like, all right, this makes sense. I will say, though, I mean, Mike, you brought up, why not go with their dad?
Right.
And I think because their dad would kind of be like,
hey, you guys handle your business.
You guys shouldn't be doing this. You know, their dad was never the most sympathetic to their plight.
Yeah, you know
while
what?
While Bobby's like, yeah, all right, what do you guys need done?
Yeah, you're looking at it from, you know, common sense. I'm looking at it like it's casting. You know, they probably couldn't get...
Oh, no, I'm taking that outside of the aspects. Bobby's more of a father figure.
Right.
Especially to
and
Sam,
at this
I'd
point,
say.
They've been through a lot more with him. Their hunting life really took on a whole new meaning when Bobby was around.
Right. And even when they found their dad in season one, he was all about, you should have shot me to kill Yellow Eyes. It was the end game.
In a lot of ways, know. Bobby was more hardcore than John Winchester was. John Winchester was hunting down Wendigos and the typical monsters. Bobby was dealing with angels, demons, Lucifer.
Right.
So, yeah. So his game was stepped up a lot more than John. And so it does make sense for them to reach out to him. Contact him.
It's the same thing as when you have two parents and you want to do something that one probably will say, no, you can't do X and Y. You can't have X and Y. Mm-hmm. You go to the parent who's more lenient.
Yeah.
As Bobby.
Yeah.
In this instance.
Yeah. And I did I'm always afraid to see heaven because
you have some expectations from other shows and things that you've seen. So
other episodes,
even earlier
episodes or even other shows, like you're like, oh god.
Well, when it comes to heaven, I only look at Supernatural because I think they've done it. I'm saying giving them credit. I mean, the way they portrayed, and we talked about this a few episodes ago, the way they portrayed heaven with
was like betrayed
with
this Lucifer.
Okay, thank you, Twitter listeners. The way they portrayed heaven with with Ash.
Yeah, right, that was really cool.
I mean, I've always been nervous for them to return to heaven when it comes to actually visiting non-angels. Because the way they executed that, it's just been so good. It's very different and unique. And the way they stuck to it in this episode, they stayed with it. They stayed with kind of the...
It changed it a little bit.
A bit, but it was still the Alice in Wonderland down the rabbit hole feel.
Yeah, very much so. You said it when we were watching. You thought it looked like The Matrix.
It's very... Matrix was kind of, you know, same a lot like idea. Alice in Wonderland type idea, too. And I did like that, how it's like, hey, find an exit, you know, from your own heaven. And even though I thought it was funny that his exit was in the exact same room they was in.
Right.
But it's TV. They're on a running time, you know, of like, what, 45 minutes?
42 minutes about.
Yeah. So, I mean, I get it. But I like the way I had no problem with it, honestly.
Would you rather him pull like a book? And the fucking
and the
chamber
moves.
Cabin opens.
Yeah. Although I would have liked to see, though, when the doors with all the people's names on it, I would have liked to see maybe something a little more pop culture-y, like a funny name.
Well, the thing is, though, it's all the Robert Singers.
Right.
So there, apparently, was there a famous Robert Singer?
Roberto Singer was there. That's my father.
Oh, was that your father?
Why would there be a Roberto Singer, though? Would it be Roberto, like... Ortega or something?
You'd think so.
Yeah.
Hey, but don't hate on the Singers.
I found it interesting that it's both last name and first name alphabetical.
Yeah.
They're apparently incredibly OCD in heaven.
Well, do have to remember...
Don't move the Legos.
Don't move the Legos.
Heaven's been around for a while, so there's a good chance that there's more than one.
Yeah.
No.
That's a good point.
There's only one real Bobby Singer.
Oh, yeah? Okay, cool.
We know this.
And did you guys like the way Castiel, you know, jumped into heaven?
His hurdle leap slash matrix move into the doorway.
Yeah. Well, the visual effect shot, too, was fantastic.
Shot.
Holy shit. Fantastic.
They must have got a budget bump, dude.
Yeah, you think?
I think they got a budget bump, bro.
Because that was a pretty intense shot.
That was a heavy special effect shot, dude.
Yeah, that was good.
They're like, here's the dust flying out of the air. I'm like, wow, that is incredible. Yeah, they had to have gotten a bump or something because the last two episodes, the special effects have been really good. Yeah.
I just loved how Castiel and Bobby, they just kind of go right back into it, how they were dealing with having to save the brothers, you know. He's like, what's going on with Dean? And he's like, I'm a terrible liar for half a minute.
That was funny, dude. Well, it's like, because Bobby can see right through that crap.
They've been together for an incredibly long time.
Yeah, he's like, all right, cut the shit. What's really going on with Dean? Like, because, you know, Cass is trying to make up excuses and shit. And it's...
I loved how Bobby says, or he's like, would you do any different? Or like, would you have done anything different than what we're doing, trying to break him out to help Dean?
No.
And Bobby's like, hell no.
Yeah.
I just wanted to know what's happening.
Yeah, like it was...
That's why they went with Bobby over the dad. Because Bobby, you don't have to explain this stuff.
You don't explain shit.
You just say, we need help. And Bobby's immediate answer is, what can I do?
Yeah, there's not, how'd you get into this trouble? It's, hey, what can I do to help you?
Now, speaking of Bobby, also... Yeah. They might have also chosen Bobby from a casting standpoint and story standpoint. It looks like, I don't know if it was just me, but did you guys think that they were possibly setting up a little story arc?
There's something going to happen.
Because the way they ended it with the angels.
Ending is what made me think that they are, yes, there will be a story arc.
Yes. Do you think heaven's going to go Old Testament now? Old school, like seasons one through, or seasons four and five?
You think he's getting 10 lashes with them?
You know, no, I can see that.
Do you think because they're trying to keep heaven, basically bring back the rules.
You know, right. Because if you think about it this way, when you start out, heaven did everything its way. Everything worked, theoretically. Right. The Winchesters show up. Castiel goes off the rails. They stop the apocalypse. They bring Leviathans into the world. They cause their own civil war and death of all their leaders.
Yep.
Or imprisonment. The Winchesters have literally fucked up heaven.
They fucked
on
up
multiple levels, repeatedly. You know, and with Bobby, the person they know that they can't even trust their own people in heaven, their own souls that they've earned paradise. Because the Winchesters have found a goddamn way, like, you know, like cockroaches or something like that. There's always one.
Whoa. Did you just...
That's what I'm saying. That's what heaven sees them as. Yeah. A nuisance, a pest at this
like
point.
Like Sam's movie, I wanted to say.
I could absolutely see heaven going, you know, what? F this. Let's go back to the ways of smiting people and being done with it.
I think Hannah was very serious. The fact that she locked out Castiel shows that she means business. And absolutely. Now Bobby helped... A guy. Now, think about it. If you start having souls, if you start allowing souls to do stuff like that, start chaos. Fucking with the way heaven is.
That's not good.
The way heaven's running. If you're allowing souls to mess with the business side of heaven, that could be a major issue. And the angels may look at that as we need to snip this fast.
Yeah.
And I think Bobby is going to end up facing some serious accusations and some serious, repercussions.
I mean, heaven trials.
Bobby has been reintroduced a couple times since his death. I think twice now total.
Yes.
And I think this was the best.
And we didn't know what happened to him after becoming a ghost and being sent to the other side. We find out he went to hell. So he'd been there for who knows how long at that point. But they never showed us that. They just said later, this is what happened. To directly show us that the angels are coming in, they know it was you, and they have a bone to pick with you. I do not see them saying, yeah, that was just a one-shot thing. They have to come back to that.
Yeah, they got to. You don't just do that. And also, they may use him as leverage to get Matatron
back.
That's
what the episode was about, right? Leverage.
Hey, it's all about leverage.
Such a badass scene.
That was
such
a cool scene.
Such a badass
scene. Which one?
The leverage scene.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Because we're still on Metatron and
Castiel.
Well,
we haven't seen Sam get real like that in a long time.
The hunt for Dean?
Yeah.
You know?
Well, even... Yeah, yeah, beginning of the season.
I'd say probably that, but with a human and or, quote, not a demon, but he's not a good guy.
Do you think Sam would have blasted a hole through Metatron?
Absolutely.
I fucking hope so.
He killed Dean.
Even though he was immortal? Like, technically not even an angel anymore?
No, I think absolutely he would have put a round in his head. After what he did to Dean at the end of season 9, and with the whole Marcus all his fault... Frankly,
but you gotta say the reintroduction of Metatron was fucking priceless. I don't care what any of you motherfuckers say. You had a smile on your face, Thomas. Okay, you had a smile on your face that you thought it was great, and you, Ryan, were outright laughing. So now I know how you guys really feel about Metatron.
Now wait a second,
because you guys always talk shit.
He's a great character.
He's in a fantastic villain,
and
I love to hate him,
but I
would
still
punch
fucking
him
hate
right
him.
In his cock if he was in front of me.
What's you and cock tonight, man?
I don't know, dude. I have a problem. I think I have a cock problem.
I would say he's a phenomenal actor. He's a great character. And that's the thing is that you know he's so good at his job because he gets right under your skin so quick.
So gets
one
under
sentence,
skin.
Just his introduction. You're like, God damn it. Why do we have to deal with this guy again?
Dude, I just want him to disappear.
But I still want him to die.
I want him to get stabbed.
I want him to be the new Crowley.
No, shut the fuck
hell.
Up.
Let me be friends.
Writers, turn more writers.
If you're listening,
him.
Please don't fucking do that.
Oh,
please spare me.
Metatron, friends with the Winchesters.
There you go.
Writing down.
They turn immortal. They kill him. He goes to hell this time. Becomes the new king.
No, shut the fuck up.
Oh, God, I would hate my life.
I don't want any of that shit to happen, so shut the fuck up, Thomas.
But it was a great reintroduction to his character. A great scene that showed how much Sam and Cass were like, F this, we're done with games.
We dropped all the fun and everything out of this, and we are straight up stone cold.
And the letter, Steve. The letter from Bobby, I think also really brought home some old school nostalgia, because it was Bobby doing what Bobby does. And it for some reason, if someone would have told me Bobby at the end of the episode, Bobby's going to write a letter about the brothers lying to each other, I would have said, oh, God damn it. We've seen this before. Yeah. We don't need to hear it again and see it again. And yet they managed to do it.
Yep.
And it felt good. And it felt right. It didn't feel contrived. Yeah. Didn't feel forced. It felt like, hey, a returned father is doing what a father would do if he had a second chance to talk to the boys.
Yep.
And he gave them the speech that he always gives them, the speech that we said they needed last season, because there's nobody that can talk to them.
Exactly. And that's where it comes from. The fact that they've had no, you know, elder wise words from somebody who they care about. They've had no direction. It's been all on them. And I think in a lot of ways, a lot of people can relate to that, because as you get older, sadly, parents and loved ones die. And no matter what, no matter how old you are, you're still at part of you is like, I'm just making this up as I go. I don't really know what I'm doing. As an adult, you don't have answers, but you always feel like the people who were older than you did. And who doesn't pray to people they've cared about and lost? You know, I feel like that's what this whole scene was that, yes, it's the same stuff that they knew beforehand, that they were told beforehand, but sometimes you need that refresher. And it's very rare that you get an actual, I mean, obviously, letters from heaven don't happen, but
yeah, that
same kind of impact.
That sounds poetic. I like that. I'm going to name my next short story that.
Letters from heaven?
I get some credit on that.
Is that going to have, like, Dr. Quinn and the medicine woman show up, too? Is that weird?
But, you know, I think that's something that a lot of people could.
What the fuck? Did you ever watch that?
No.
He's got Netflix. He's just binging.
Dude, I binge everything, dude.
But I think that was an important scene, because the brothers still needed that. Even if it's just Sam in this instance, they still needed that.
I would agree with you.
We've been kind of holding off on Dean. Are we ready to jump in?
Yeah, I think so.
Oh, I am so ready to jump in on Dean.
You're swinging on his bicep?
Yes. I'm going to orgasm.
On his 12-incher bicep?
12-incher
bicep. No, he doesn't have the 22-inch pythons.
Good God.
When we get Jensen on an interview, I'm going to bring this whole story up. I'm like, dude, we were kind of talking about your body, dude, and we kind of got into biceps. It'll be great, dude. Remember.
Can I have a bicep?
Running time, an hour and 1 minute.
There you go.
We've only been on an hour.
And we're going, and I'm going to remember, I'm going to pull the tape, and I'm going to, next time, when we get Jensen Ackles on the show, when we do, I will bring this entire story up of what happened.
That'll be the last person we have on the show.
And then I'm going to tell him, dude, while we're talking right now, here's my cell phone number, tweet me, send me a message right now, live, of your bicep, and we'll decide it right now on the air.
Dude.
Are you buff?
Let's have a measurement. Let's have a measure contest.
A cock-off, dude.
Yeah, let's see who has the biggest bicep, dude.
Low angle, though. We got to go Michael Bay, dude. Michael Bay.
No way, bro. I'm going straight top angle, because you can see straight down the shaft.
You've taken too many dick
top
pics.
Top angle makes it look... You're obviously not a filmmaker, dude.
Bro, I know how to make my dick look good. That's all I know.
A high angle shot, dude. Diminishes the subject.
Oh, no. See, I don't think Mike. No. I think Mike's lying when he said he's never taken dick pics.
No, I'm just saying.
It diminishes it. You got to get that underneath. Listen, not that I know.
I'm an award winning cinematographer. I know my shots. Yeah. You see that poster there, dude? 25 awards.
Adult films.
45 awards of what? From Phoenix Comic Con?
Oh, please. Fuck that place.
Oh, wow. Shots.
Anyways.
So on to Dean, and not like the way Ryan wants to.
Mm-hmm.
Wait, see how he gets us off subject?
I know, dude. I told you. 40 fucking minutes of extra content, because Ryan's going to derail the whole goddamn show.
Dude, I'm sorry, guys. All right, you guys go
ahead. He's going to go back to his pictures of Dean.
Dean.
Dude, okay. Ryan is going to be doing a WB show. Okay, a WB CW show.
Now?
Yeah, well, I'm just going to say, he's going to end up doing, probably next year, he's going to be doing a DC show.
Yeah.
And he's gonna be the main host. And it's going to be a nightmare. It's going to be this the entire time.
No.
Did you see how his pecs rippled in that last shot?
I'm not a homo or nothing.
I almost sound like a queer or nothing, but I'd fuck Stephen Amell. I don't sound like a queer.
I think you just did a little bit.
What? Oh.
Anyway, if we can try and move on. Right. If Mike doesn't choke to death on soda or beer or whatever he's drinking.
Thomas hates me.
I think he kind of does, dude. I think
I don't hate you. I'm just hungry.
I'm sorry, Thomas.
I realize he never laughs at your Lou Ferrigno joke, dude.
Dude, he hates Lou Ferrigno.
Bro, gets on my fucking
bro. He fucking hates Lou Ferrigno.
Oh my god.
He hates that it's funny and he hates that people know it.
You're right. We just went off 5 minutes.
I know. Just count it up,
dude. All right, hold on.
Put the goddamn mic back. Anyway, we see that Dean doesn't have a lot to go on. He's kind of bored. He's trying to keep his mind off the mark, obviously. He calls Rudy, which did a quick check.
Who
he's
the
just
fuck is
he's
Rudy?
A hunter they talk to over the phone.
Have
That's
we
all
ever heard
been.
Him mentioned before?
He's been mentioned before.
Can you go to Super Wiki and
yeah,
see
look,
that, Ryan? What
yeah, Thomas, I'll look it up.
Yeah. So
give me something to do. I'll shut up.
But we see that he's bored, so he goes to his old, you know, hangout bar, his hole in the wall place to chill and get, well, as Ryan said, nachos that took half a freaking second.
Dude, holy fuck. Any place that I go and I order nachos like that, that takes fucking 45 minutes.
Maybe they just know Dean.
They were like, oh, Dean's here.
Keep nachos warm.
Like, fuck, man.
And we see those guys playing pool, and that immediately reminded me of seasons 1 through 5, even when Rob Benedict's Chuck's talking about, you know, they would hustle and make some money here and there, and that whole Lifetime flashback. Same yeah. vibe here. Yep. And you knew he was going to play them as soon as it shows them being, they're so douchey.
Dude, super
so douchey.
Super. And you know what's funny, dude? I got the whole, like, the Color of Money.
Yeah.
Kind of feel vibe to that. You know, like, I love that movie. I don't know if you guys have ever seen that with Robert Redford and
we know the movie. Yeah.
Anyways, I just got that really cool feeling watching it.
Yeah.
With him hustling those
dudes.
He's
going to screw them over so hard.
Yeah. Oh yeah. And they're not going to do shit about it. That was the cool thing.
Yeah. I thought that was, again, another nice flashback to previous episodes, but we see after he wins the money, goes in the bathroom, we see the whole demon eyes for a half a moment.
Dude, that fucking
now. Now, this I have to bring this up.
What do you think that was?
At this point, Rowena had shown up to the building,
right? But I don't think she had anything to
her,
do. Know.
Was that her at all?
No, I think that was
head.
I think that was Dean, dude.
Or do you think that was just straight
mark,
up
bro.
The mark?
Okay.
I think that was the mark.
Do you think it was a hallucination?
I think so.
Or do you think it was him starting to transform back to a demon?
I don't think it was
or,
him transforming.
Or third, was the spider senses tingling?
Danger,
I'm being serious.
Danger in
like,
the room?
Was the spider senses tingling? Was it, hey, there's a witch in the room. There's
it's never done
there's
that
There's danger
before,
coming
though.
Your way, and the mark is going to start acting up.
I don't think it was that. I think it was much like, was it season 3, the hallucination of this is what you're going to become, you
that's,
know.
That's kind
of
what I got from
the,
it.
He's constantly afraid of that. He's looking in the mirror all like several times now. We saw the broken mirror scene. That was a phenomenal shot.
You think it was like hell's coming from you type hallucinations
I don't
like
know if
in season 3?
I don't think it was
Remember
that either.
How he
I
had
just think
hell
it's,
hallucinations?
Yeah. I think it's just straight up fear. He's afraid of that happening. He's been with Sam and Cass. You know, he's always been around somebody. This is the first time I think we've seen him just kind of on his own. Since he got transformed back to a human.
That was the thing that I thought was interesting was that he's like, well, all right, well, I'm just going to go hang out and do whatever I want. And it's like, I feel like you should stay in the bunker.
Like, I think that was, again, I come to, you know, drugs and alcohol. The first time you're like left to your own devices, he's like, yeah, I can handle it. And then you go out and do your own thing. And you're going to have that temptation, that flicker. The last time he was in this dive bar place, I mean, obviously he's a regular there. But we saw him at the place in episode 1. That's where he hung out. It has to remind him a bit about that lifestyle.
Yeah, I mean, I could understand that. Yeah.
Yeah, I agree.
That's what I got.
And by the way, I Googled Supernatural Rudy. Dude, I can't fucking find
it. Wiki,
he's a made-up hunter.
It says he's a hunter who has spoken on the phone.
Oh, you
with
found
Sam
it?
Dean. Yeah, he doesn't have a page.
You found it, but not.
Yeah, I... It's a different wiki. I used a different one. I saw the one he was on.
Did you use Wikia?
W-I-K-I. I think you were on Wikia, but either
You're
way.
You're on the generic one, Ryan.
Dude, I Googled, I searched, I put in Supernatural Rudy character.
He doesn't
Rudy
even
Hunter.
Have a page. So he's just somebody they've talked to on the phone. They've done
so
that
they
a couple
have.
Of times.
Okay.
But either way, we see that Rowena was in the bar at this point. And we'll jump ahead, or not ahead, but around a little bit to
hot redhead in a dive bar. Dude, doesn't get much steamier than that.
Her first shot was the steamiest. Are you kidding? She's painting the blood sigils on herself.
And
in
you know
nude.
What? It brings back the weird sexual taboo. Dude, tell me you don't see it.
Of witchcraft or
no,
of...
the Crowley, the fucking incest, dude. You don't see that they're playing with that a bit, dude.
With her being naked,
I don't
and
see
him
Crowley having.
Yeah, they keep
no,
they
I
keep
see, I don't.
Going back to that. Like, I'm not saying they're doing it on. They are. I have a feeling that maybe I'm doing like Destiel moments.
Do you know
in my
what
own
I got?
Yeah, are you shipping over here?
I'm not shipping. I'm just saying. I think. Listen, witches are paganistic. They're sexual people. And there are no rules. Okay? So I'm wondering if they're playing with that taboo, that sexual taboo, which that's one of the darkest taboos.
Right.
Maybe a darkest mainstream taboo is incest.
Right.
And I see that they're...
Game of Thrones
to me,
did so well.
Yeah. Oh, so hot, dude.
Ooh.
I'm sorry, but if Cersei was my sister, I'd be having a brother and a son at the same time.
Ryan's face right now. Holy shit. I think you just crossed the line for Ryan. That's a first.
You're a sick puppy.
Oh my God. Wow.
Ryan, you're telling me Cersei is it steamy? Get back on the mic. You're telling me Cersei.
No, she's hot, but yeah. If she's my sister, I wouldn't put my dick in her.
But what if you grew
Let's
up
say
in,
that
what
now.
If you grew up in different homes?
It's still
and you didn't know.
You're just making the reason.
You're just making just shit up.
What if she wasn't related to you?
Oh.
Like, that's the next step you have.
What if she had a blood transfusion?
I'm your sister. I'm your sister. Joe Dirt over here?
What if she had a complete blood transfusion?
What if she was a different person and from another planet? Like, why not? Why stop there?
I'm just saying. Okay, I'm just saying that they're playing with taboos. I mean, dude, come on.
I get what you're
they
saying.
They keep doing it, man. They keep doing the
I didn't
awkward...
get that vibe.
He walked in on his mother naked.
Naked, yeah.
I
see,
think
so. You agree,
I think,
Ryan.
Write what you know.
They are.
Write what you know. Maybe
are.
Someone had a traumatic experience.
No,
as a child.
I think what they're doing.
I think Carver has a thing for his redheaded sister.
Maybe.
Ugh. I'm going to beat you like a redheaded stepchild. I think what they're doing with that is. I would tend to agree with you, Mike. It just seems like there's some sexual tension there that they keep playing up. And it's like, look, yes I know
think,
these two actors.
I don't
actors,
think there's any subtext.
No. There's no subtext.
That.
I think it's just because the two actors are this of the same, almost the same age.
There is tension there. Yeah. And I get it. I do get the father-mother thing, for sure. I feel that. But at times, maybe it's just my own perverted mind, but sometimes
I think
feel...
it's your perverted mind, bro, because I have it too. Because I'm perverted as fuck too.
See, I'm weird, but I did not get that vibe. I mean,
he doesn't like redheads, bro.
No, I absolutely love redheads, but either way, some people have had the traumatic experience of seeing your parents have sex or do something.
Thank God, I never.
And you
have.
Say write what you know, so maybe somebody. It's simple as that. But more interesting is what the fuck the blood sigils were.
Well, what? Yeah, what was she?
Is that a power up boost? Essentially,
yeah, it's a
one
up.
They never explain that. She uses it. Against Dean
does
as
nothing.
Some kind of like angelic colored wave of death that was supposed to rip him apart.
And what exactly? I don't know.
And
what,
did fuck all.
Now, did she do these sigils based on something she may have known about the mark?
She didn't know he had the mark at the point. At that point, she had no idea that he had the mark of Cain on him. Because remember,
Crowley says it later. Crowley tells her later.
But she
knew what it
but
was.
She seemed to know what it was.
She knows of the mark.
Yeah.
She didn't know he had it.
She knew it was a curse.
So what was she? Do you think she was trying to kill him there then?
Absolutely. She was trying to kill him. Yeah.
I think was a way to kill him that possibly, you know, you can't just bring him back to life.
I thought she knew he had the mark because she is the one who knew that guy got the first blade.
Just because
you
have
the first
blade
doesn't
she doesn't know about
the mark.
She knows
the
first blade can kill people.
And she knows the first blade.
She was really preoccupied with other shit.
Right, but what I'm saying is that just because you have the first blade doesn't mean you have the mark.
Exactly.
It's not like the Sword in the Stone.
No, it's not the same thing, dude. Oh.
And she knew. I think she knew that Cain was about.
I was out of stuff
for a while.
I know you were.
Yeah.
So I was really interested that they didn't explain what that was—the shockwave of death—and surprised by how the mark's just like, fuck that.
Your power for spell, horseshit.
Because before she said that without the coven, you know, above her, she would be nearly unstoppable. So this mark just shrugs that attack this off, was no the, question.
This was the first foray into like, I don't give a fuck magic. Like, I don't, there's no coven, and I'm just gonna fuck you up. Kind of like that it didn't work, though. It shows how badass the Mark of Cain is. Now, again, we've talked about this. Witches are fucking powerful as shit. So whatever that spell was dangerous. And the fact that it didn't even, like...
It didn't even...
I mean, in a lot of ways, they're more powerful than certain demons. They're more powerful... I mean, you, again, we bring keep bringing this up, but we've seen angels kind of... Or witches defeat Leviathans, at least put them down.
Put them down, take out demons in a single hex bag.
So it makes you think... If Dean had the Mark of Cain back during the Leviathan days, do you think he'd be killing them?
I think he could have.
He'd have slaughtered them with the first blade.
All that killed, you know, Dick Roman was a bone blessed with some blood.
Yeah.
You know, yeah, it was a ritual based on the tablet.
Dick
but
got dicked.
The first blade, the father of murder, I gotta think that trumps it. Made by Lucifer himself.
Yeah. God, it's so good.
Oh, God, dude, the lore on that is still just
Well,
so
what did
cool.
Metatron say? We never brought that up. We should probably bring that up.
We should bring that up. Thank you, Mike. This is what happens when we do it right after the show.
Yeah.
When they make him mortal, he actually says that he was just buying time and coming up with some crap. You know, the only thing that could probably remove that is that's God-level magic, or he says, or Lucifer-level.
And they paused.
And there's a pause.
And then he says,
distinct one.
But we can't ask him now, can we?
So can we?
Man.
Oh, that's all I want. All I want is Lucifer to come back for the end of the show.
What if, dude?
Oh, here we go.
Can they keep this secret? Can they keep that secret?
I don't know.
Do you think they could, with a show
like this,
do you think they can keep...
Follow every tweet?
Or not Pellegrino. What's his name?
Bro.
Mark Pellegrino.
Do you think they can keep Mark Pellegrino sneaking into the studios to do a scene? Do you think they can hide that?
I hope to God
they could.
Then again, we're assuming
Marvel
he's going to have the same...
secret? There's no way they're going to be able to keep that secret.
Then again, he doesn't have the same... meat suit either, so I mean
he could
vessel.
Why not?
Dude, the vessel fell in there with him.
No, he left the vessel in Detroit. Yeah.
Oh, that's right.
But I mean, Abaddon recreated her vessel.
There's no reason you can't come up with some reason.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
What if they go to Lucifer? That's the ultimate. Final, you know, let's find a way.
Desperation. Opening
attempt.
The cage.
Lucifer kills Crowley because he's the new leader of hell.
Oh, Jesus.
And that's you. That's your whole new... You brought Lucifer back and Crowley's down, all hands on deck. That's the finale.
Man. Do you think Sam and Cassiel would risk unlatching the cage to save Dean?
I don't think you can.
I don't think so.
I think they would. They'd be dumb enough to. Honestly,
yeah. Well, not dumb, but
not desperate enough.
Love, dumb.
We've done this before. We can put him back. It'll only take a second, you know. I want that to happen. I want that to happen so bad.
This is one of those episodes that just had looking at each other. We're watching it, and it had so many what ifs. Okay, what if they do that? Okay, I can see this. I can see that. And there's no way they can possibly put all that what ifs in there.
They can't do that and not touch on some of them.
I think that pause on Lucifer was done intentional. I mean,
I want that to happen so bad.
God magic. We can't just go ask. Lucifer,
exactly.
Now can we? Yeah, it seemed a bit foreshadowing, in my opinion.
A little bit. But so then Rowena's doing some sigils, and she's trying to find out exactly where the Winchesters are, because she wants the Men of Letters bunker. And I like how they use a Microsoft Surface in Hell. So apparently, Hell is sponsored by Microsoft.
Yeah, Microsoft, Bill Gates decided
this whole
Hell
thing is just confusing.
I stopped.
I mean, obviously, okay. So obviously, in heaven, it's there's symbolism to heaven, just like Hell.
Right.
But then there's also, it seems to be like in Hell, you also can take your vessels, obviously, are also your Surface Pro. I guess there's a certain part of Hell that's real.
That's tangible.
Obviously, they're walking around. Rowena's there. They're in their vessels. Crowley's in his vessel. And I mean, and then you have a tablet. And that's what was interesting about Hannah. Going back to that for a moment. She obviously wasn't a vessel. She had to actually possess someone to communicate. I don't know why don't they do a little like smoke talk? You know what I mean?
That would look goofy, dude. Come on.
As goofy as going into a dude and talking like a woman?
What's wrong with that?
Some men have women inside them. Come on, dude. God, what an asshole.
Well, I mean, heaven seems to be, both of them actually, these dimensional places where there's, it's like a giant corporate building just run differently.
Yeah.
You know, heaven's all these rooms. When this is your individual paradise, right. You're not allowed to transverse in the hall without a hall pass. Meanwhile, hell is you wait at the DMV line for fucking ever. And then maybe that's just how Crowley has changed it. You know, we don't really know. But I do kind of stop paying attention to the exact architecture of the different places.
Yeah. I've stopped caring so much.
No, I'm not bothered by it, but I
laugh
I
that the Surface
get,
was used, and it's like, oh, yeah. Windows 8, it is that shitty. I like 7.
It belongs in hell.
Exactly.
If the app would have crashed, that would have been the best part of it.
I was surprised that Dean not only resisted, though, from killing just that guy on the ground, but he also didn't do anything to Rowena. Just let her go.
Yeah.
Mark and all.
I would have done things.
And, of course, we see how sadistic and nuts she was, but, like, I'm going to fuck myself up just to prove to Crowley. That was an iffy. So we see that she clearly wants the bunker of the mental letters, but she was just going to straight up kill Dean with that blast.
Yeah.
And she claims it was for Crowley, which I don't buy that for a second. And this leads to her, you know, manipulative streak. And I got, when she was yelling at him to be a king, do this, stop being a bitch, frankly, I got a serious Macbeth vibe. They're not married, but it's the same thing. It's like, you could be better. You should be king.
Yeah.
Do this, you worthless maggot.
Yeah.
Yelling in the background, forcing Crowley to do things, not exactly yet, but stuff that he may not want to do.
Yeah.
Right. But I don't think that she forced him into doing anything. It kind of showed.
Yet.
I think this episode showed how Crowley does view the Winchesters. I think anybody that might have been on the fence with how Crowley truly feels about them. He has no other plan. He has no agenda.
Just keep your friends closer, your enemies closer.
Yeah.
I think he used that as an excuse, dude.
He just likes them.
I think that conversation with Dean, that moment, dude,
was the
real
Crowley.
That was a real moment. There was all the lies, all the facades were gone. And when Crowley and Dean sat there, both of them, for the first time ever,
were serious.
Were real. It wasn't Dean being a demon, and that I'll be cool with you and party with you because I'm a demon. It was Dean as a human flawed being, and Crowley as a flawed being.
Yep.
It was real.
Yep.
And I think we finally put the rest of the fact that Crowley has no agenda when it comes to the Winchesters. I think it is what it is. It's right there.
Yeah. You see Crowley's face, him almost make like this when Dean's talking this connection. And it's like with those two sitting, that was, like you said, is a very real moment. And I think you're right. I think that there's no agenda there. Crowley just is bored out of his fucking mind.
He wants more.
He wants friends.
Yeah, I think
a family, somebody to care about.
He's been working so hard, and I think people who've reached their potential have all been there. Like, okay, great. I'm on top of my world. What's next?
Now what?
Yeah. And he doesn't know it's not what he thought it was going to be. I don't think he enjoys it. I don't think it's fun for him. And I think he, because of the trials, I think he obviously has a longing for love and family, and that's why
he just wants to be loved.
Yeah.
And that's why I think, you know, he was so nice to Rowena for a long time, and he kind of used almost like I think because he's heard the Winchester say, it was almost like computerized or programmed into him saying, well, why are you putting up with Rowena? And he's all like, well, she's my blood.
That's what you guys
like,
do.
And he was almost doing it like programmed because he heard them say it so many times. And then it's almost like Castiel moment where he doesn't quite understand human nature.
But if I keep doing it like they do, maybe I'll figure it out along the way.
Did you get that too? It was almost like he kind of didn't understand it and he thought he was doing the right thing. And then when Dean had that talk, that Dr. Phil moment, as Ryan called it, like,
it was definitely a Dr.
Like,
Phil moment.
It kind of like hit home. You're right.
To me,
you know, family isn't blood. Family are the people who put you first and have no, you know, agenda.
And I loved how they used a Bobby quote in the episode with Bobby.
Yeah,
family doesn't end at blood.
Yeah.
You know, and honestly, you know, shipping aside, that really did feel like a scene between exes meeting up at the bar. Like,
oh, totally.
What's going on with your life? Ah, it's kind of fucked up now. Yeah. It's a little awkward, but they know you better.
Old friends, too.
Yeah.
I mean, I've had conversations like that with people that I kind of like the bridge
the
was
friend
burned
that you haven't talked to in a long time because something happened.
Yeah.
but they know
life,
you better.
Real life happened.
They know you better than anyone else, so they can just tell you flat out, yeah, you are weak now. You are soft. But then
dude,
again,
when he said that, dude, Crowley's face was just like,
just like he didn't want to admit it. Yeah. He knew. That's why he was, you know, playing, you know,
this,
I'm king of hell.
But
I don't
at the
have
same
to do
time,
X
I don't
y.
know if necessarily Crowley cares. Like, he I think he dude. Doesn't want to be manipulated with his mother. And I think he was, I don't know if he was hurt necessarily by his mother, but I think that talk was more or less not about, hey, I'm going to start acting tough to the Winchester. It was more like, I'm going to take control of hell and not let this woman fuck shit up anymore. She's obviously manipulating me and I'm over it.
She's sowing a seed of discontent there, dude. And what I think she, what he finally is saying is like, hey, not so much I'm going to go back to being old Crowley, but I'm going to go back to being old Crowley here.
Yeah.
And I'm going to fuck you guys up if you don't do what I say.
It's the same thing as anybody who's had family that, you know, is frankly bad for you. You know, whether they bum money or they have a drug problem or they use you for whatever, sometimes you got to let that aspect go and realize that there are other people in your life who are more family. And they didn't say it, but I think we all kind of got that vibe that Crowley considers the Winchesters closer family than he does Rowena. He tried with Rowena. He's like, well, maybe here's an opportunity to have something like what I want.
It's actually mine.
Like they have Sam and Dean, somebody who gives a shit. And he's found out that you're not going to find that with Rowena because she's just a manipulative bitch. Frankly.
Yeah. I mean,
and then he kicks her out full blown. Just get the fuck out, pack your shit, and go.
Which
and
is.
She made her way to my house.
Which is the catalyst
for the
rest
of the season.
As we were saying at the beginning of the first segment.
Stealing my word.
I think is the catalyst. Yeah, dude, because no one else uses that word.
No. Not even.
I think it's the catalyst that will, you know, spur.
Absolutely.
You know, the final confrontation.
Well, you could tell when she was walking away by herself, she was fucking pissed, dude.
Hell hath no fury.
Like a redheaded Scorn.
Yeah.
Redheaded hot chick. I think her attitude's more hot than her, honestly. It's just her attitude.
She's hot.
Everything.
She's attractive.
All of it.
Yeah.
Either way, that definitely, like you said, Mike, sets up, this is going to be the problem. Crowley doesn't give a crap about hell. He has no reason to stay in many ways.
I think we're finally getting a picture.
Exactly.
Of what to expect.
Exactly.
Like, fully expect.
We're heading in the direction.
Yeah.
We had to go through all this, you know, personal moments and development. And I think it's come together really well, frankly, especially with Crowley. Before, I remember saying, you know, what is he doing? He's got to be smarter than this. And you see this whole time, he's like, I just never cared enough to pay you any mind at all.
Yeah,
I tried. It didn't work. And you're a bitch. Get the hell out of my house.
Yeah. That was pretty much it.
Pretty much
verbatim.
But I definitely think that's going to be with no coven and no home and just somebody who has something she wants and she's pissed off. She only has one target in her sights, and that's the Winchesters, and maybe Crowley.
I think Crowley's on that list.
I think so.
I think Crowley and the Winchesters are all on the same list for Rowena.
Shit list.
And she's now that she knows that the Grand Coven is pretty much not in it, not
she can
powerful,
do whatever the fuck she wants.
She's either going to try to take over the Grand Coven and get more power from them, and then she's going to try to invade the Men of Letters bunker.
I think she's just going to go straight for the Men of Letters.
Yeah. So I think she's, in, like I said before, I think she's going to end up being the one of the main issues / villain now towards the end of the season.
Yeah. I just don't see them introducing any other villain. I mean, she's pretty. She's
can you guys see
it.
Now Crowley dying?
I can.
For the Winchesters?
I think that would be the end of his story.
Yeah.
The closing of his arc. He starts out as this evil guy who is self-serving.
God, what a good story arc when you think about it.
He's self-serving in season 5. He just wants to live, and he knows Lucifer is going to result in all kinds of bad.
Right.
Then he goes into, I'm the king of hell, look at me, I'm such a badass, into you find out what he really wants and his relationship with the Winchesters, with the Leviathans being too big a threat.
Yeah.
And then you see what we've seen with Carver's run of what he really wants, what he finds out he really cares about. And like you said, when you're at the top of the mountain and you look at the devastation behind you, there's no one next to you. It doesn't mean anything.
Yeah.
And I think him sacrificing himself, which I think that's what it would be.
Like the ultimate sacrifice.
More of a Rowena tries to kill Dean or Sam and Crowley takes
he
the
does
blast.
He jumps in the jumps in front
jumps
of the bullet.
Jumps in the way. As cliche as that is, I think that would work. It would show that
and it would
he's
make
become
sense.
Human.
Yeah, it would make
finally.
Sense.
Would he be all, help me take this mask off?
But I think every that would time. Make sense. It would be a good closing to a story. And frankly, where else can you go with him?
And it might be one, if they were to do that, and they were to kill
it
him,
it would be
season,
tragic.
I would hate it. I would hate it. But you know what? If they were to kill
you'd
him,
you'd hate
in
it
that
because
fashion,
it was good and you missed the character,
right?
Not because it was bad, though.
I would go out on a limb here and say if they were to do that with him, Mark Shepard's character in the history of television, it might be one of the best arcs of a character in a television show. It's something for the records, in my opinion. You know, if these type of shows got true attention from Emmys,
right,
and stuff, like Mark Shepard's performance in the last 6 years
has been
and
pretty
praiseworthy.
It's just is phenomenal, and
well, it's
and I think it would be at a. I don't want him to die, but if they did, it would be a fantastic end to a wonderful ride with his character.
I think with that character, I mean, I see what you're saying, Mike, with him on that level of like what he's done with that character. I just think his overall performance as Crowley, being able to go from different modes of Crowley, I guess if that's the way you want to, is incredible. I would absolutely agree with you on that.
Yeah.
I mean, he's an incredible actor as is. I mean, so
then I always say leave people wanting more, and Crowley finally becoming good, finally working with the Winchesters, having it.
That's what people want, dude.
That's what we want. Be like, yes, and then he's dead, and we're like, fuck.
Well, I mean, I don't know if it was me, but did you guys want? I kind of wanted Rowena to be like, oh, so you're trying to help my son? Okay, cool. Can we all be friends now?
Like, nah, she's not like that.
I wanted that.
It didn't help just her enough.
I know. But he's selfish.
I know.
What a bitch.
So with that, guys, let's do our final grading. Ryan, what do you got?
Oh, okay. Let me go back to my notes that I actually did take more than one, Mike. So fuck you. How's that sound?
You took it in between.
This episode, I because we just watched it. There were some parts in this episode that I really, really enjoyed. You know, it's any episode of Supernatural, it's pretty funny that we, all three of us sitting there, could pick things out that we kind of laughed about.
Right.
Like things that were, you know, the Surface Pro and things like that. Like I think if we watched anything, any Supernatural episode, we'd be able to pick that stuff out.
Yeah.
I think the introduction to Bobby coming, I think he's coming back, dude. And not so much coming back, but I think they're going to do a story arc with him with the way the episode ended. And I 100% agree with Mike. I think that it's a great way to bring that character back. Because man, honestly, watching him on screen, I miss Bobby so much.
Idiots and everything,
just
dude.
Miss the character so much.
There's definitely an element that I think when you see Bobby back in the Bobby role.
Right.
Right.
It's definitely something that you miss.
There's something missing.
And
without
I
him.
Think like, you know, some people think, oh, maybe he like kind of like we were saying with Mark Shepard, that his story kind of ended,
yeah,
and we can kind of see it ending with Bobby. I don't think he needed to end, honestly.
No,
not at that time.
I maybe eventually, but I think he could have been fine in the role that he was in, and it just kind of, and this episode kind of in my mind just, you know, solidified that, like, yeah, you know what, we didn't need Bobby to go.
I think with this episode we got to, I'm actually happy that we got to see Sam and Dean kind of separated, to see Dean kind of react on his own, because we know he's getting worse. So being able to see him kind of go and, I guess, blow off steam, like his version of blowing off steam, was interesting, because you know that that mark is itching on his arm. And I think it's interesting to see him in everyday settings. So I really like that aspect. Again, another episode, this is two in a row, that I think they got a higher budget on special effects, or they hired someone who is awesome. Because there were a few shots in this one that were pretty good, dude. Like, really, really good.
Yeah.
The episode in general, I really liked. I mean, now that we've talked about it, I just think you guys might be right. The Crowley story arc is dangerously close.
It's in the crosshairs right now.
It's in the crosshairs, dude. And I think, with Rowena now being the official, I'm going to call her the official big bad of this season, it could get very interesting. I would give this episode, I really, really like this episode. Obviously, but besides the little things that we nitpicked.
Yeah, we always, you know, do
which
that.
We always
Nothing's
do.
Nothing's perfect.
I would give this an
Except
A.
Swan.
Well, yeah, you were like,
Swan
you blow that one.
I would.
That's gay. I would give this episode an A minus.
Okay.
I just liked everything about it. I liked that the desperation to go get Metatron, even though I fucking hate Metatron as a character. I think it's a very useful tool on them, and it's a great way to bring Bobby back in. So I think the episode, the story wise, special effects, seeing Dean by himself, A minus.
All right, Mike, what about you? What do you give this episode?
I'm going to have to agree with Ryan.
A minus.
A heart attack.
2 weeks in a row here. A minus as well. I kind of pretty much said my thoughts throughout the entire episode this time. Right. So I'm not going to repeat myself. It was kind of hard to follow the script because I'm so used to watching it two times in a row. but the writing I thought was good. I don't know when it comes to act breaks. I can't really break it down this week. I didn't have a chance to analyze it.
There's a lot of different moving parts.
But the writing was good. And there was a lot of foreshadowing that I hope actually comes to fruition. I hope we actually see it. I thought Metatron played his role. Bobby played his role. Everybody played their roles to a T.
Yeah.
And it was old school Supernatural.
Yes.
In a lot of ways. And that's all any Supernatural fan can ask for. I don't think there's a lot of complaints that that people could say this week. I think it was an episode that really delivered a lot.
Yeah.
I think we talked about this last week, but we needed to start seeing some conclusions.
Things moving forward, yeah.
Things moving forward. And I think this episode, we kind of got a good picture. I think a small part of the puzzle was actually placed this week. So we can actually see a better part of everything.
The picture's becoming a little more clear.
Yeah. And I think that's what almost every fan has asked for this season. I think we're seeing a little bit more in the direction where they're going. And that's why I'm giving this an A minus. Visual effects was good. Acting was just fucking spot on everybody's
so
part.
So spot on, dude.
And this is the episode that you like because nobody was left in the back burner. Sam got to be 100%. Dean got to give 100%. Everybody gave. I mean, we finally saw, you know, Castiel no longer shitting in his cereal. Crowley no longer was shitting in his cereal. Everyone kind of came out the box this season and kind of got out of their morbid, their morbid demeanor.
Right.
So A minus.
All right. I agree with you guys as well. A minus for me. This one had great writing. I thought this one, for me, anyone that really moves the main story ahead enough is probably going to get a better grade than the traditional Monster of the Week, with a little tidbit here at the beginning and a little bit at the end. It touched on everything. It made the picture a little more clear. It felt like old Supernatural with the jokes and with the, frankly, little lies to protect each other. Bobby's bit in this whole thing. I loved Crowley's bit. I loved the scene with him and Dean talking about maybe we're getting old, And I think a lot of that hit home for fans even. It's been a decade, man. I mean, some people have gone through several different schools at this point, possibly different marriages and stuff like that. A decade of your
That's
life.
That's not very nice.
No, I'm just saying that like a lot happens in 10 years.
I've changed my style like four times.
I wasn't actually thinking of you.
No, not
at that
school,
point.
Dude, bro. No, make
and
fun
now
of
I,
my
divorce. Now I do feel like a dick.
No, make,
I hadn't thought
make
of
fun
that.
Of my divorce, dickhead. That's not called school.
All right, so I will.
Whatever, dude. You're fucking like a new chick every night. Sit down.
I'm a single guy, right?
Yeah, you can cut that out of the show. Fuck
this. Dude, she's probably listening.
Doubtful.
She wants to know what you're doing.
A decade is a long time. And I think that this, seeing that Crowley's story could come to a satisfying end, seeing that this whole season hasn't been just meandering about while we came up with a villain, but actually had an entire motive.
There's a whole reasoning.
A whole reasoning. Yep. Seeing that light just a little bit at the end of the tunnel on this one.
Oh.
Made this one matter a lot to me. Oh. So I think this one is probably one of the better ones of this season, just because we got a little bit of everything and everything moved.
We really did.
And we got a God reference, which I always love, and a Lucifer illusion that maybe he's coming back, which would be so cool.
Yeah, weird they didn't, we got a God reference, but it wasn't Chuck. That's really weird.
Right. Because he doesn't know who Chuck is.
Fuck you,
he's
guy.
Been living in a freaking... He was reading
you,
books
Chuck.
For years.
Yeah, there's my drop. Do it again.
Fuck you, Chuck.
Yeah, there we go. Thank you.
No, but for this one...
I just want to be loved.
God damn it.
I give this one an A minus as well. So I think
that's
three A minuses from all of us.
Hell yeah, dude.
Thomas fucked us on the last one.
I did. I ruined it with a B minus.
He ruined it with a B minus because he's a cocksucker.
All right, guys. With that, we're going to take a break, and then we'll be talking about the upcoming episode, Book of the Damned, in just a minute.
I'm ready.
Hello, Rain Man Digital listeners. The new Rain Man Digital app is now available in the Google Play Store. You can now take the entire Rain Man Digital Network on the go, anywhere you want to go, on your Android-based device. Whether you want to listen to Supernatural, The Crossroads, The Rain Man Show, Critique Revolve, Weird West Radio, or Star Wars From the Back to Tank, it doesn't matter. You can take all those shows now on any Android device. So go to the Google Play Store and search Rain Man Digital and download the free app today. The app will also be available very soon for iPhones. So keep checking in.
This is Crossroads 003.
Welcome back, guys, to Supernatural The Crossroads. We got a last little bit here for you talking about the upcoming episode, episode 18, Book of the Damned. Now, we don't actually have a written synopsis for this one because, again, we went just after the show
ended. Right after
ended.
The show, yeah.
So we're just going to base our discussion today about the trailer that we saw.
Here's what I think is going to happen. I think Ash from Army of Darkness is going to show up, and they are just going to basically chase after
he's
going to
chainsaw Rowena, right?
I'm going to chainsaw Rowena.
Oh, good lord. So in the little clip trailer we saw, Charlie Day, that from It's Always Sunny shows up. Mix the two names.
Felicia Day
shows up, and she has the Book of the Damned, which is, I guess, a spin on the Book of the Dead from other lore and stuff. The Tome of All Kinds of Knowledge is written on human skin, which is
gross.
Now.
Yes.
No, go ahead.
No. All right. So she has something important to bring the brothers, whether it's exactly about the mark or not. We don't know.
Let's go.
It hasn't been that long since Charlie was in the show, though.
It hasn't. It's only been
like
a couple
four
episodes.
Four or five episodes.
Well, it's good that they're keeping true to what they said, basically.
That she finds something, she'd show up.
Yeah. So obviously, this has to do with the mark again.
Now,
do you think she, in order for this to be interesting and to be like realistic, because honestly, who's Felicia Day? Like Charlie? What does she know about the mark again? And the only way this would make sense for her to kind of find something would be hopefully she's using the knowledge that of the
from Oz.
That would be cool. That'd be a cool tie-in. And it would make a lot more sense if they use that.
I think you kind of have to, because you're not going to find that in a library.
Charlie's character as she is now, do you think she would have the ability to actually bring something, find something on the market? How would she, what connections does Charlie have?
Here's the thing. Yeah. Here's the way I
look at it. It has to be connected to Oz. She has to be able to find something because of that.
If the brothers have searched high and low and the same things over
Google,
and over
let's be
and
honest.
Over
Sam
and over.
Just
he's Googling on his phone. She probably went to like Egypt and dug through the sand to find this thing.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
She LARPed it into existence.
It would have to be something to that extent. And it has to come from her knowledge from Oz.
Right.
Something.
But what has she shown us that she has knowledge from Oz at all? She hasn't shown us anything.
Dude, she took on an entire army. Remember the Civil War of Oz was won by her single-handedly?
But did we see that? I'm just saying, like,
it was
we
really
an episode,
cool, we
no,
were told.
We don't see it,
well,
but we
she's
were
come
told.
Back, and we haven't seen her actually
No,
use
but we
that.
Know that
That's
she
what I'm
has.
Saying.
She was dealing with the you know, identity crisis issue.
Use your brains.
At that point,
I'm saying you haven't seen anything. I want to see her do something cool.
We're going to see it.
I know, and that's why I'm excited.
I think in the Book of the Damned, it's going to be like, hey, you know, when I was in Oz, we heard about this location. Hey,
you know, when I was in Oz, we had to walk 15 miles uphill with our fucking swords on our back.
She's an old crotchety parent now.
Thank God Ryan isn't right for the show.
I would be a great writer.
No, I mean, I think, like you said, it
fuck
has
you,
to.
Chuck.
So, guys, in the season finale, we're going to reveal that Chuck's God. And you're like, I think that's bullshit.
That's a bullshit
from the
thing.
Writing table.
What have we seen? What have we seen
Chuck do? How do we know?
Look at this guy.
Wow.
Because I created it like that. I don't know.
You know what?
You're not saying it, man.
Your creation's horseshit, and I think that he should not be God.
And then Kripke smites you right there. No, I think this one has to deal with the mark. I mean, that was the whole point of her coming back. Yeah. Was that she'd come back when she had something.
Now, do you agree, Thomas? Obviously, Ryan does not. Do you agree that in order for it to make sense that she found something, it would have to be some knowledge?
Well, how did I say I didn't disagree
from
with that?
I don't think so, because you can always, as sad as it is, you can always come up with some reason as to why she found X or who she met through her studies.
Charlie Day.
See? Ha! You did it too now.
So Charlie, someone who knows absolutely nothing. She has no connections to the hunter world, nothing. She's going to be able to find this Book of the Damned through LARPing knowledge.
I'm not saying I don't believe Oz will play a role. I'm saying I don't see why they couldn't come up with some reason for Oz to not play a role.
Obviously.
Yeah.
They can write something, but are we getting, it has to be believable.
What do you guys think about this episode, though, in general? Do you think, I'm just skipping ahead that, this one cannot be as good as this one we just had. After all the main story plots, all the different threads, the kicking out of Rowena.
I don't know.
It has to do with the Mark of Cain, dude.
To be completely frank, we haven't always been super excited about Charlie episodes.
However, she's directly connected to for the first time since the Leviathan.
She's connected
tied
to the main
into
story.
The main myth arc story. And
which is
that's
definitely something going for
it. And that's all I ever asked, as I said before, about Felicia Day. People think I don't like her, but all I've ever asked is for her character to matter in the episodes.
Her to be her character.
Here.
Yeah.
Her to be a person and her story to matter.
Right.
Rather than a guest star like those old episodes of Scooby-Doo with the Harlem Globetrotters, you know?
Dude, those were awesome episodes, though.
That's what it felt like before. Not that it was an actual regular episode. Right.
It was more of a promotion for Felicia Day in the past.
It felt like that, yeah.
And I think this past episode, it felt more like an episode. It was about Supernatural and not about Felicia Day.
So we're hoping this works with Book of the Damned.
Well, the Book of the Damned is a fucking fantastic
cool
title.
Lore. Hopefully we'll get some new additions to that.
I hope we actually get some new lore. That'd be cool.
And dude, what if it's a book about like stories of Lucifer? Almost like, you know the Dead Sea Scrolls? You know what those are?
Yeah.
The Dead Sea Scrolls, how a lot of it's not considered biblical canon.
Well,
that the Catholic Church and a lot of Christian churches don't recognize it as canon. But a lot of these, you know, these scrolls from the Dead Sea they found, the Dead Sea Scrolls, they kind of correlate much with portions of the Bible.
Right.
So what if the Book of the Damned was almost like that? Just stories that were not told in the Bible about Lucifer.
Maybe, and all the bad stuff that's
and the
happened,
mark
horrible
of Cain.
Things that have been lost
dude,
to history.
That would be fantastic.
That'd be strong. That'd be strong lore, dude.
I'd be way in for that, dude.
That would be fucking cool.
I want to know also where she finds this, because that seems something, like you said,
Amazon.
Ancient stuff.
Hardcover edition, $2,000.
I don't imagine the Book of the Damned being found in America, you know?
Right.
I imagine that in Egypt, Jerusalem, something like that. I imagine it being from another country entirely.
It has
but
to be.
That means that you open up the world again, and maybe we have, you know, Travis Aaron Wade's, you know, globe-trotting hunters.
I think Travis is done for the season.
Yeah, I don't think
no. I'm not saying coming back for the season, but I'm saying another reason as to why. There's stuff throughout the entire world there. I mean, we had that auction where there's Thor's hammer, for Christ's sake.
So good. That I liked that part. It was cheesy, but it was cool. It was cheesy, but cool.
It didn't even look like Mjolnir.
That's stupid.
So I'm interested to see this history behind this book and what it actually can do for them.
if it's bound in human
maybe
skin.
Maybe it's just spells? Maybe? Tied to the coven? I mean, that would make some sense, too.
Well,
we don't need another thing that Rowena
definitely
wants.
Think, I definitely think this will connect to Rowena from here on out. I think the fact that Rowena knew that it was just some curse Aunt Rowena, and the fact that Crowley made it a point to say to Dean,
she knows about it.
She said it was just a curse, and it could be, you know, taken care of. It removed. They said that for more. Yes, it was more. It was for the reason of showing that Crowley cares,
right?
But it also was done for other reasons as well. There is hope.
It's not always throwaway,
right?
Not stuff like that. In this episode, we just saw is not, but. Yeah.
So,
looking forward to it.
I mean, yeah, I don't know if Castiel's going to be in it, I'm sure.
He has to be, right?
I guess we'll just have to wait until it comes out.
Yeah. I'm actually looking forward to this.
I am too.
This is the first Felicia Day episode I'm actually really looking forward to.
Oh, wow.
Oh, man. Now, we actually have a week without the show.
Is
it 2 weeks?
A week without 2 weeks,
we have to wait.
Yeah.
Right, from today.
Yeah. It's kind of funny they're doing that again. Like, yeah, I'm kind of wondering.
Yeah. They just came back for two shows, three episodes.
And now we have a week off, so.
Hey, I'm not complaining.
Fucking loser.
Wow.
You don't want to work 24 hours?
What a fucking shot fired. Go fuck yourself, Thomas.
I just want to be loved.
Fuck all you guys.
I just want to be loved.
That doesn't. God,
I was saying
so
he's
bad.
Being
that's
crazy
so
for wanting you to.
I just
all
want
time.
To be loved,
dude. That drop is so bad. I sound so bad.
Thomas
in that.
Loves it's
so
it. Look good. At his face. Thomas's face is like sheer giddiness, dude.
Oh, fucking with me, Thomas. Lou Ferrigno is going to come out next show.
Oh Lord,
yeah. Thomas is like ear to ear, dude.
I just want to be loved.
It was so unexpected when you did that.
Fuck you.
It was great.
It was the worst impersonation of all time. I really think so. Oh my god.
Anyway,
we got to wrap.
So, guys, we will. You'll have to wait, sadly, 2 weeks to hear from us again. But if you give a shit, if you give enough of a shit,
this show, and I want to apologize. This show's probably
this
not.
Show's oh, this is happening.
This is what happens when we do the show
guys,
5 minutes after
it's
the
my
episode.
Fault.
We're two
blame
hours.
My fault. I didn't do show notes.
Blame me.
Well, I
how
there was
you
no
have,
show
though?
Notes on this. I mean, we did
well,
the first,
how do you do
first
show
segment
notes?
Was good. Second segment was good. This segment was okay. But it's that middle segment where there's no show notes because we didn't have time to write them down.
We meandered about. Ryan kept talking about dicks and stuff, so we got sidetracked.
I just want to be loved.
I just want. Yeah.
You know, but we're 2 hours behind when we're normally done at this point, so.
I'm tired.
Bear with us, guys. And
I just want to be loved.
Thank you for listening if you still are at this point. All right,
guys.
Either way, always, guys, tell your friends about us. Leave us reviews on Stitcher, Facebook, Twitter, all that. Let us know what you think about the episode, and we will talk to you all next time.
Bye.
Little maggot, you are no longer a part of this story. Hey, ass butt.